through SeaWorld and how I went from being, you know, somebody who really loved marine parks and felt, just as what Kevin was talking about, just was so happy to get the job there, and just, I was really proud of my experience at SeaWorld for a very long time, to going to the other side, to being a really an anti-captivity activist. So I really never thought that I would be in this position. I never thought I would be in a book, and I also, there's a movie, a documentary film coming out in March that also features a bunch of the people in this book, and so that may potentially be a big deal. So again, I never really expected to be in this position, and this is where I am, so I thought I'd tell you guys a little bit about the journey. First of all, we tried to get David Kirby, the author, to Skype in today to talk to you guys a little bit. Unfortunately, he's out of Wi-Fi and cell phone access today, so I want to give you a sense of how, first of all, how the book started. David Kirby is the author of two other books. One is called Evidence of Harm. It's about vaccines and autism. And the other book is called Animal Factory. It's about basically what goes on behind the scenes in factory farms. And both of those books did really well. David really writes about corporate malfeasance. So he was on the Larry King live show when he happened to be there when, about a week and a half after Don Branchow died, this would be February of 2010, he was in the green room waiting to go on for the show, and Larry King happened to be interviewing Linda Simons, who was, she was hired to be the safety officer at SeaWorld of Florida, and she was hired literally a week before Don Branchow was killed. And so Linda was tasked with helping out in the investigation that OSHA, the Occupational Safety and Health Administration, she was tasked with helping OSHA gather materials for their investigation. And about a week into the investigation, Linda was fired. SeaWorld told her, "You're not doing a good enough job and we want you out of there." So she actually sued SeaWorld, and she said they fired her, they didn't have grounds to fire her, and so it became a big deal and she ended up on Larry King Live. So there's David Kirby in the green room listening to this conversation from Linda Simons, who'd been working at SeaWorld for maybe a couple of weeks, had gotten nothing but positive reviews from her senior management, and then all of a sudden was fired because they said that she wasn't doing a good enough job with the investigation. So David thought, wow, this sounds like a really great story about corporate malfeasance, and I'm going to start looking into behind the scenes at SeaWorld and look at what's going on. But he had heard the story about Don dying, and it was in the back of his head, but he never really thought about the plight of the whales at SeaWorld. It never occurred to him to think about, you know, what is it like to be a whale or any of the animals at SeaWorld. He was just purely concerned about the employees from a employee health and safety standpoint. He thought something was going on, so that's why he started investigating. And through the course of his investigation, David, who really tries to stay very neutral, has actually now come down on the side of feeling that these animals in particular, killer whales, do not belong in captivity. So I'll tell you a little bit about his journey, that, and you'll see it through the book. What he decided to do was follow a woman named Naomi Rose, who's the senior scientist at one of the senior scientists at the Humane Society International. He decided to follow her story through the book. She started out as a killer whale researcher and ended up working as an anti-captivity spokesperson. And then to contrast that with behind the scenes at SeaWorld with some former trainers who had actually come forward and who are willing to talk about what goes on behind the scenes. And by the way, let me let you guys know, I will just talk forever, so if a question comes up while I'm talking, please raise your hand and I'm happy to answer. So Naomi Rose was working on her doctoral dissertation in the early 90s, the same time me and three other trainers were working at SeaWorld. So the book actually goes back and forth between Naomi's experience in the wild, working with wild killer whales in Canada, and her finally getting hired at the Humane Society, and then it contrasts that with my experience at SeaWorld. Three other trainers, Jeff Ventre, Carol Ray, and John Jett, their experience working at SeaWorld, and so it kind of goes back and forth, and you get to see sort of our journey through the book and how we end up where we are today. One thing that the book starts out with that a lot of people didn't know about, and this is where I'll kind of start my journey, is that the whale that killed, does everybody know about Don Branchow, who was killed? Okay, so in February of 2010, there was a trainer at SeaWorld in Orlando. She was killed by a whale named Tillicum. Tillicum is about 30 feet long, he weighs 12,000 pounds, and he'd killed two other people. So Don was his third victim. Don had 16 years of experience as an animal trainer. She was hired 6 months after I left the park, and so when I heard about it, it was quite shocking to me because I knew that this woman had a huge amount of experience, and I realized that if it happened to her, it literally could have happened to me if I'd still been there or any of my friends that were still there. And so it kind of woke me up, and it started me thinking about my experience at SeaWorld.
Why did they keep whale that killed two other people? How do they keep on going?
That's an excellent question. Killer whales are priceless. They're insured for millions of dollars. And Tilikum is a male. 54% of the whales in SeaWorld's collection have his genes. He's related to 54% of the animals now. So before they got Tilikum, they had another male whale. His name was Duke, and Duke died. And so SeaWorld acquired Tilikum after he killed another trainer in 1991, which I'll tell you about in a moment, at SeaLand of the Pacific. Basically, they wanted him for his sperm. So they didn't really care about his history and the fact that he'd been involved in the death of another person. And while Tilikum was at the park in 1999, a guest in the park stayed overnight and evaded security and somehow managed to get himself in the pool with Tilikum. He picked the wrong whale, unfortunately, and Tilikum killed him. So that was the second death, and then Don Branchow was the third death.
Did the whale eat these people, or?
No. So the first death in 91, well, let me tell you what, when I was working, I was actually working at Shamu Stadium at SeaWorld of Orlando when Tilikum arrived. And so as a trainer there, I did not know anything about this animal's history. So I'll tell you what I thought I knew back then and then what actually happened. This would have been in about early 92 is when Tilikum arrived at SeaWorld of Orlando. He killed a trainer named Kelty Byrne at SeaLand of the Pacific in 91. What the training staff was told about the death at SeaLand of the Pacific was that Kelty Byrne was a fairly inexperienced trainer. The trainers at SeaLand of the Pacific in Victoria, Canada, did not do water work with their whales. So she was wearing boots and rain gear. She slipped and fell in the water, and she died very quickly from hypothermia. And all of the whales did was play with her dead body. And Tilikum in particular, because he was in killer whale society, the females are dominant. And so Tilikum was accustomed to not being able to get the toy. Basically, if the females got the toy, they wouldn't give it up. So Tilikum got her body, and he carried her around for 2 hours, and he wouldn't give her up. That was all I knew. That was the story that I heard when he arrived. So my understanding was that he didn't have anything to do with this trainer's death. Now, at the time, it was 92, and there was no such thing as the internet, and I didn't have any reason to think other than what management told me. Of course, now you can go and look on the internet, and you'll see that this woman's death, what actually happened was Kelty Byrne was a very good swimmer. She was, she was a pretty significant athlete. She did slip and fall on a very slippery deck. Her foot dunked in the water, and she was actually getting out of the water when Tilikum grabbed her and pulled her into the water. It was just new stimulus. These were whales that, unlike SeaWorld, this was a much smaller facility. The whales were bored, and they did not do water work with their animals, so they didn't understand what it meant to have an animal in the water with them, a human in the water. So they did grab her, and they played with her kind of like a sea lion. You know, they batted her around, and they kept her from getting away from the side of the pool. They, tried throwing life rings in there. They tried to get her out with one of those shepherd's hooks, and they were not able to get her away, and eventually she drowned. But she lived for 10 minutes, at least, and people heard her screaming, and she came up for air a bunch of times, so it was a pretty horrific death. The whales didn't brutalize her as Tilikum did to Dawn 20 years later, but it was a pretty horrible thing to watch if you'd been there as an audience. And somehow SeaWorld managed to cover that up because it happened in Canada in 1991, and so the information wasn't given to, I'm sure upper management knew about his history, but the trainers that were working there, people low in the totem pole, like me, didn't actually know what happened. So that's what happened to the first person he killed. The second person he killed in 99, I've seen all the autopsy reports. The second person, his name was Daniel Dukes. SeaWorld tried to paint him as a vagrant, as a drug addict, as a transient. They said he snuck into the park and stayed after hours, and in fact, SeaWorld was basically blaming him for his own death. He did have an arrest record, so SeaWorld played that up as though he was an unimportant person. But really, probably what happened was, just like everybody else, he was enthralled by the idea of potentially swimming with killer whales. So he decided he would, hide out after the park was closed. And we don't even know how he got in the water, because honestly, this death didn't take place in front of an audience, whereas the other two deaths did. So we know that there were cameras that night at Shamu Stadium. We know that there was a newborn calf in the front pool. So there had to be at least four people on staff at the time. And we know, according to the autopsy report, that this guy got in the water probably around midnight. And nobody saw him until 7 o'clock in the morning. Now, the reason people are on staff at SeaWorld Stadium at night is what they call whale watch. And so people are supposed to be taking respirations of all the whales every half an hour. If there's a mom and a baby, there's more staff, so there's more people around. So to me, the fact that they did not, that supposedly nobody saw this until 7 o'clock in the morning, that's a lie. If you look at the autopsy report, again, this guy was fairly well brutalized by the animal. Not to get too graphic, but his testicles were on the bottom of the pool. It was probably a drowning, and he was significantly brutalized by Tillicum. The third death, Don Branchow, was actually more of out of the three attacks. It was really significant because the whale continued to ram her after she was dead. He broke her breastbone. He scalped her. He ripped her arm off. It was pretty brutal. And again, in front of an audience, many people saw this happen. And so. Yeah, your question is valid. Like, why would they have an animal that would do this, and why wouldn't they have a harpoon, or why wouldn't they have a gun? You know, all zoos across the country, when you're dealing with dangerous animals, they have harpoons, or they have guns, or they have something. And these animals, because they're so priceless, and because they make so much money for the park, nobody even considered. I think one security guard said he thought that maybe he should shoot the whale, but at that point it was too late. So anyway, that death, Don Branchow, that happened in February 2010, and I heard something on the internet. I was at work, and something came through the internet that somebody had been killed at SeaWorld of Florida, and immediately it flashed in my head, this was probably Tillicum. I didn't know anything about the details. I was really concerned that it might be somebody that I knew, and it turned out to be somebody that I didn't know, but she was close to everybody else that I knew. In fact, every time I turn on my Facebook, there would be a note, do you know Dawn Branchow? Because she knows 25 people that you know. So I knew of her, and I knew that she had had quite a bit of experience. And I started paying really close attention to the news reports that were coming out about this woman's death. And so the first thing that SeaWorld said about her death was that somebody slipped and fell into the pool. So that was the first news release. That's what the Orange County Police Department reported. It took, I believe, 12 minutes between the time that she was killed and the time that they called the police. So there was a lag time between when she actually got in the water and when the police were called. Then they started to change their story, and eventually, because there were people videoing at the time, the show that Dawn was doing was something called Dine with Shamu, and it's a show that's done in the back pools at Shamu Stadium. The main show going on in the front pool, where the whales are jumping and people are swimming with the animals, had taken place about a half hour before, and Dawn was doing a show called Dine with Shamu, where basically she was demonstrating to a group of visitors who were eating lunch how SeaWorld trains their whales. So it was a much more low-key show. It was kind of a Q&A opportunity for people who wanted to pay extra money. And, some people, it was a special thing for them to get a little bit more close and personal with a killer whale and talk to a trainer. So that was the idea. What we know about the show, when I say we, I'm working with a group of people I'll talk about in a little bit, but what we know about the show that happened beforehand was that there was some kind of disturbance in the front pool. The whales refused to perform. A couple of the whales raked each other. There was a little bit of blood involved in that, and the trainers had to stop the show. And so the show ended early. And so what we think happened is that there were what we call VIPs in the park, very important people who were at that show and were maybe not given the best show. So Dawn, when she was working with Tillicum in this kind of smaller show after the main show, was trying to give people a really good show. And therefore, she did make a few mistakes with this animal, which I'll tell you guys about. One of the things that does anybody train dogs? Anybody have experience training dogs? Yeah. Okay, so you guys know about reinforcement. When an animal does something well, you want to tell them that they've done a really good job. At SeaWorld, the way you reinforce an animal is, everybody seen those whistles that the trainers blow? With the whistle, it's called a bridge, and it tells the whale, you've done a really great job, now come back and get your reward. Because a lot of times the animal's doing what you ask them to do, but they're doing it really far away. So you have to have a way to communicate with them. Another way would be to slap on the side of the pool, or maybe an underwater sound that tells the whale they've done a good job. So in the very beginning, I've seen the video footage of her working with Tillicum, and in the very beginning of the show, he's with her. He's really responding incredibly well, and then she gives Tillicum a signal to do something called a perimeter peck wave. What a perimeter pec wave is the whale goes on his side and he waves his pectoral flipper and goes all the way around the pool waving his pectoral flipper. It looks like the animal saying hello to everybody. So Don sent him on this behavior and he started doing this beautiful pec perimeter wave all the way around the pool. And about midway through, she blew her whistle to say, hey, you did a great job. And for whatever reason, Tillicum didn't respond to the whistle. So I don't know why, whether he didn't hear it or whether he was actually ignoring her, but he didn't respond. And he continued the entire perimeter of this pool, went all the way around the pool and came back. And Dawn did what trainers are taught to do if an animal makes a mistake, which is she gave him a neutral response. So at SeaWorld, if you've ever been to a SeaWorld park, they tell you they don't use punishment with their animals. They give them what's called a neutral response. Neutral means that the animals made a mistake, you just stand there, you count to three, and then you move on. And these animals are very intelligent, so they learn very quickly. That means you didn't do the right thing. So from that point on, after the neutral response, watching the video, you can see that Tillicum is not really paying attention as much as he could be. He kind of sinks down lower in the water when Don asks him to do a behavior, which I'm calling a behavior, but they're actually tricks. He doesn't respond incredibly well. He seems like he's just sort of half there and half not. And at the very end of the show, you can still go to YouTube and you can see video footage of Tillicum and Don. And Don runs out of food, and she's basically trying to reinforce him using rubbing him down or using a bucket of water in his mouth, which the animals like, but they kind of know when you've run out of food. And the last frame in the video is Don lying down in what's called a slide-out area. It's a shallow area of water. It's about 5 to 6 inches deep. She's lying down on her belly next to Tillicum in the water. And you can see Don's kind of like this, and Tillicum, oh, she'll do it this way. So if this is the ledge right here, and Tillicum's in the water, his head's here like that, and she's lying down completely vulnerable in the water next to him. And we think that potentially what's going on is that she was rubbing his tongue, which is called tongue tactile, like saying, hey, you did a good job, and just doing a little relationship session with him. The video camera shuts off, and the next thing that happened is he grabbed her arm and rolled her over and took her in the water, and really that was it. And then he really beat her up and brutalized her. So that's what actually happened. Again, that took a while for all that to come out. Between February of 2010 and when I actually started speaking out publicly about what happened at SeaWorld, several of my friends, our two former trainers at SeaWorld, were contacted by Tim Zimmermann, who's a writer for Outside Magazine. He ended up writing a piece called Killer in the Pool about what happened to Don. And so two of my friends kind of reluctantly agreed to be interviewed by him, and I actually read that article. And then I started doing a lot of research into everything that I thought I knew while I was at the park, and I started looking at how the animals actually get to SeaWorld. What is it like to capture a killer whale? What's it like to be a killer whale? What's it like to be captured? You know, these animals are ripped from their families when, you know, they're sometimes 2 and 3 years old. I didn't know this when I was working there, but male killer whales spend about 70 to 80% of their time within a couple of body lengths of their mothers. So they have incredibly tight social structures, none of which I knew about when I was working at SeaWorld. Some other things I didn't know about. Go ahead.
What did you do at SeaWorld?
Oh, sorry, I was an animal trainer. Yeah. So I was hired as an animal trainer. So in 1990, and while I was there, I got to work at all three of the animal stadiums. So I worked at the Whale and Dolphin Stadium for a year and a half, where I worked with beluga whales, Pacific white-sided dolphins, bottlenose dolphins, and spinner dolphins. And also false killer whales. And then I got moved to the Killer Whale Stadium, which is Shamu Stadium, and I worked there for about a little over a year. And then I was moved to the Sea Lion and Otter Stadium, where I worked with sea lions, otters, and walruses, and then left after about 3.5 years. So anyway, these animals have incredibly complex social structures in the wild. They swim anywhere from 80 to 100 miles per day. And at SeaWorld, all they do most of the time is they kind of sit motionless at the surface of the water. We call it logging, and they just hang out. They don't really do much unless they're being interacted with for a show. Killer whales, one of the ways they interact with each other and also other objects in their environment is by something called echolocation. So echolocation is where they send out sound and it comes back to them through their jaw, and they process that sound in their brain. So in a way, that's their eyes. And in a tank, the sound bounces off the tank, and there's this also during the shows, there's this loud booming music. And so you can imagine a killer whale being in a tank that uses sound to communicate in the wild is basically like if we took this room and we made it about, you know, down to a third of what it is, and then we put mirrors all over the wall. So there's light being reflected at us all the time, and everywhere we look, we see our own reflection or other reflections. You know, you would probably go mad too in that situation. So so the animals have in captive environments live nothing like what they do in the wild. So I want to go back a little bit to why I'm standing here in the first place. Like how does one get hired at SeaWorld? Does anybody have any questions at this point? Okay. So as Kevin said, in 1990, I'd sent resumes out all over the country to different marine parks. At the time, I think there was about, I went to the library, I got a list of, there's probably 30 some odd zoos and aquariums all over the country, and I sent out resumes. I had an animal science degree, a little bit of experience working with large animals, CPR certification, some experience with public speaking. I was a strong swimmer, and I was hoping to get a job at a place like SeaWorld. So in 1990, I get a phone call from, January of 1990, I got a phone call from SeaWorld. They asked me to come down. They didn't fly me down. I went down on my own dime, and they had me go and take a swim test before they would interview me, which basically involves swimming to the bottom of the pool at the Whale and Dolphin Stadium. 25 feet down, it's about 72 degrees, so it's not particularly warm. Pick up a weight, swim as far as you can underwater, do a bunch of push-ups. They put you on a microphone, you carry some buckets, and that shows that you're physically fit enough to do the job. Does everybody know Jack Hanna? Have you guys seen Jack Hanna on TV? Jack Hanna is known for comparing SeaWorld trainers to astronauts. he compares what SeaWorld trainers were doing is with astronauts. So if you listen to my resume and you look at the resume of an astronaut, you'll see it's rather dissimilar. I'm kind of offended by that comparison. Really, you know, I was just lucky and there was an opening at the time. You know, I had the minimal qualifications. I had a BS in animal science and you know, I look good in a wetsuit. But really, they weren't looking for scientists at SeaWorld. In fact, I was expecting that I would be participating in research. And the only research that happens at SeaWorld, I've come to find out, is really how to keep the animals from dying so they can keep them alive long enough to make money off of them. You know, they say that we now know that killer whale gestation takes 17 or 18 months, whereas they used to think it was 12 months. SeaWorld's been saying that for 30 years. So there's not a lot of real research that goes on there. I think while I was there, there was one scientist, his name was Frank Fish, ironically, who was doing thermodynamic studies on dolphins. He was basically, we would have the dolphins swim across the, in the front pool, across the glass, and he would photograph them, and he was looking at, kind of like you would with an airplane, to see what kind of drag I didn't even understand a lot of the calculations, but, you know, they took video, and then they took that information home, and I never saw any of it. I only recently saw the paper. So, anyway, I got hired at the park, started in February of 1990, and really, I thought I was the luckiest person in the world, because, you know, what a thrill to swim with dolphins and to swim with beluga whales. And I didn't, you know, like a lot of people at the park, I really bought everything that the PR machine was generating. I told people exactly what I was supposed to tell them about the fact that we feed the animals restaurant quality fish. I told them that male killer whales and the female killer whales at Shamu Stadium had dorsal fins that were bent over. And SeaWorld trained the trainers to tell people that was normal, that dorsal collapse occurs in the wild. That's in fact not true. Any whale that you see in the wild with a collapsed dorsal fin is fairly close to death. You know, a lot of the things that I told people about these animals' natural history and their lifespans were right out of the SeaWorld PR department, and I did not question it. So, you know, I spent 3.5 years, one of the things that I'm embarrassed about is I spent 3.5 years basically lying to people about these animals, you know, because there was information out there, but all I knew was the SeaWorld party line. And I think when Don was killed in 2010, what it started for me was this process of waking up and really thinking about, because I had been having these dreams for 20 years about this place, and it made me think maybe there's something I need to go back and do. But I didn't speak up for another 6 months, which I find really interesting, even though I happened to be probably the only person on the planet who was at Shamu Stadium when Tillicum arrived. I know what SeaWorld said about the animal, and I know what they said to the press, and yet I was reluctant to come forward. And so I think part of me really thought that the SeaWorld van was going to pull up in my back door the first time I said something in public and whisk me away. And so that shows you a little bit about how the employees are treated at the park. I mean, it was really clear that if he wanted to continue working in the industry, and, you know, I think there was still some part of me that had held on to, maybe I'll go back working with animals someday, that you don't say anything about what you saw. So I started to look back at my whole experience there, and two of the things that stand out that I want to share with you guys, and then I'm open for questions. But two things that I saw that I was working at the park that I thought were particularly tragic that I somehow managed to talk myself out of and not think about, perfect example of cognitive dissonance. One was an animal named Celeste. Celeste was a dolphin who was a captive-born dolphin. Her mother was named Shannon, and her father was named Lester. Shannon died before I got to the park. She had a fungal infection, and the veterinarians treated her with some kind of antifungal medication, which she reacted poorly to, and she died. So Celeste, her daughter, grew up without her mom to protect her and really without a father, so she was kind of an orphan dolphin. She really bonded to humans, and she was the kind of dolphin that you could jump in the water with and just hug. I mean, a lot of the dolphins were interested in you if you had food, and if you didn't have food, they were like, forget it, I'll see you later next time you come back with a bucket of food. But Celeste, because she was really raised by humans, was kind of imprinted on humans, and she was like a dog in that way. I mean, she just wanted attention. And I could jump in the water with Celeste and play with her for hours, and she wouldn't care. I mean, she was just a wonderful, sweet animal. And unfortunately, because she didn't have a mom to teach her basically dolphin behavior, she was pushed around by some of the older females. And what eventually started happening about 6 months into me being at the Whale and Dolphin Stadium was the older females would, what we call, displace her. And what displace means is they would just nudge her over when they were getting fed. And they started to kind of poke at her, and eventually she started throwing up her food. And then the older animals would get her food. And what started happening for Celeste was that the more the older animals knocked her out of the way and the more she threw up her food and the more those animals ate that food, the more reinforcing it became for that pattern to happen. And eventually, even though I was an animal trainer and everybody else at the stadium was an animal trainer, we could not train her out of this behavior. And she started throwing up her food even when the older dolphins were not around, just so she could play with it, because that became more reinforcing than actually eating the food. So I actually watched this dolphin who I love starve to death over a period of about 6 months. You know, to me, I mean, considering everything that SeaWorld says about there being the foremost facility for marine mammals, and that we know everything there is to know about these animals, we couldn't help an animal not starve herself to death. And eventually, Celeste ended up looking like a skeleton, and even despite tube feeding, she died. So it was just, for me, that was just tragic to see that we couldn't keep this animal alive. About 2 months after I arrived at the park, has everybody seen the movie The Cove? Okay. So The Cove talks about the Taiji in Japan, the dry fishery in Japan, and it looks at how some of these animals are captured for marine parks and also for meat in Japan. The false killer whales that we had at the Whale and Dolphin Stadium were all obtained via the dry fishery in Taiji, and there were four false killer whales at the Wild Dolphin Park when I was there. Again, I knew nothing about the dry fishery because I knew nothing about how these animals were captured in the wild, but often those animals came to SeaWorld very sick because they were held in very small pools with, in some cases, 20 or 30 other animals. So they came with viruses and bacteria and fungal infections and yeast infections and parasites. And so we were constantly stuffing their food with antibiotics and vitamins and antacids and antifungals. And so one of the false killer whales named Zori was sick from about the day that I got there. I don't remember her ever being able to do shows. She was always, we were always calling the vets because she was never looking right. And about 2 months into my being at the Whale and Dolphin Stadium, one of the trainers came running over to me frantically and said, "Sam, start taking respirations on Zori. There's something going on." And all that meant was I needed to sit there with a pad of paper and count how many times this animal took a breath every 5 minutes, because they wanted to have a record of it. So they called the vets, and I was running around the pool watching Zori. And what Zori was doing was she was thrashing around the pool. A false killer whale is about 20 feet long. They weigh almost 2,000 pounds. And she was maybe 15 feet long. She was thrashing her head against the side of the pool. She was thrashing her body. She was swimming tight circles in one pool. They were trying to corral her into a medical pool to try to get the false bottom up so they could hold her and keep her from drowning. Because basically when a whale's in the middle of their death throes, whales breathe air, so they will drown. And so she was fighting for her life, trying not to drown. Eventually she ended up beating her head on the side of the tank, and this huge amount of blood came just flowing out of her mouth, like nothing like it. Like it was like she was vomiting her guts up, and then she just sank slowly to the bottom of the pool. And I watched all this, and the two vets from SeaWorld were there, and they were standing on a gate over the medical pool just watching her, and one vet said to the other, "Gee, I thought we were out of the woods with that animal." And that was it. And then Zori was carted off to the freezer and chopped up for dog food. So that's the respect that the animals at SeaWorld get. So again, you know, I saw these things, but you know, I was also mesmerized like everybody else by the story that the park talks about how these animals get the best care, and that, you know, the animals get better care than the people, and in some cases that was true. So again, you know, to see all this and yet to not, and to be able to go and do my job every day, I find, does anybody know what's going on at Marineland right now? I don't know if anyone's seen. There's a trainer in Marineland in Niagara Falls in Canada who was working with the animals for 12 years, and he just quit a few weeks ago because the conditions for the animals are so horrific. And he stayed for about 12 years because he kept thinking he could make a difference, and he finally left, and he just organized a protest at Marineland, and it happened yesterday, and 400 people showed up. Usually they get about 20 people to show up. So the word is getting out there about, you know, what goes on behind the scenes at places like SeaWorld. And, you know, unfortunately, SeaWorld is one of the better facilities. They do have a lot of money, and they do, as far as industry standards are concerned, they do the best that they can. But unfortunately, there are certain animals like killer whales, beluga whales, dolphins, polar bears, that just don't do well in captivity. Just because of the kind of lives that they live and that they live in their natural environment, they don't thrive. And so one of the reasons I was willing to talk to David about this book and be willing to be interviewed is because this is something that I feel like we can do something about. There's only 43 killer whales in captivity all over the world. And if everybody refuses to buy a ticket and stops going to the shows until places like SeaWorld and Marineland or SeaLand, until these places stop putting these animals on display, forcing them to do shows day in and day out for dead fish, you know, and giving them environments that are completely deprived of you know, what they would get in their natural environment, you know, what we can all do right now is basically just stop buying a ticket. And if these guys are not making money off of these animals anymore, they will have to do something else. You know, from my standpoint, what I'd like to see is that they stop the captive breeding programs. They stop, which are actually inbreeding programs, because all the animals, are practically related to each other right now. They're not breeding healthy animals. That they bring the animals who are not healthy enough to what's called a sea pen, like an area in the ocean that they can pen off, where the animals can be taken care of for the rest of their lives by humans, but they won't be forced to perform for their food. And they would also get to hear, you know, the natural environment. They get to hear the sounds of the ocean. They get to have some semblance of normalcy. But some of the animals are actually releasable. They're healthy enough that they could be retrained. Does everybody know about Keiko? The Keiko story, Free Willy? Keiko was in that movie Free Willy in 1993. He was actually rehabilitated and trained to go back into the ocean. He swam several thousand miles and was on his own for months. Eventually he came back and wanted attention, and the Keiko project helped him out and took care of him until he eventually got pneumonia and died. The captive marine mammal industry paints Keiko's situation as a failure. They say that was, you know, that was animal abuse. But this animal went from living in the tiniest pool in the industry, the warmest pool in the industry, of being incredibly sick, to actually swimming with his own kind in Norway and Iceland, and so he actually got back out into the wild. So if they could do it with this animal, they could do it with several of the other animals are good candidates for release. And the last thing I want to leave you with is there's a few whales out there that deserve particular attention. Not all of them are at SeaWorld. There's a whale is really close to my heart. Her name's Lolita, and 42 years ago she was captured off the San Juan Islands. She's a member of the Southern Resident Group of Whales. In the late 70s, SeaWorld pretty much decimated the population of southern residents by taking a lot of the babies out of that population and putting them in the display industry. Lolita's is the only survivor from several of those captures. She's been in now what is the smallest pool in the industry in the U.S. at the Miami Seaquarium. She's had no companion other than a dolphin for the past 20 years. She hasn't had another killer whale, and she's completely on her own. And her mom is still alive in the wild. So her family still actually exists in the wild. So she's put in 40 some odd years doing, you know, 3-4 shows a day, you know, for her entire life. And this animal right now, we could stop that show and we could rehab this animal and put her back with her family. And she would likely recognize her family and be able to go back with them. Several years ago, somebody offered the owner of the Miami Seaquarium $1 million, which was at the time what Lolita was insured for, to take Lolita and to rehab her and put her back into the wild, and her owner refused. So, you know, if nothing's done about this, one day they're going to come into the pool and Lolita's going to be dead. You know, what's going to happen is she's going to die in captivity where, I mean, I think she's put in enough time. I mean, she's put in, even circus animals get to retire. Killer whales, what retirement is for killer whales is you die and then they chop you up and they turn you into dog food. So, you know, I think this animal, when you look at the complicated social structures, and if you read the book, David Kirby goes into the natural history of these animals and what kind of lives they lead and how complicated their families are, and you start to see that this is really a form of slavery, what we're doing. And these animals get shuttled around the world. They get put in boxes and put on airplanes and moved around to try to change the social structures and ensure that they're making more whales for their captive breeding programs. All of the parks that have killer whales are really kind of in it together, trying to keep their breeding program going because they can't really capture these animals from the wild anymore. But it's really tragic, and you know, it's a small thing considering everything else that's going on in the world, but again, it's something that we can do something about. And you know, I think the message that we would send to the next generation if we actually stop the shows is a message of hope and about real genuine care for these animals and the environment. So, any questions?
So, what does SeaWorld do with all their money?
I have no idea. They donate a very small amount of their revenue to what they call conservation. I think they have $1 million set aside that goes to various, people can apply for grants, you know, so there is some money that they give to research, but they make like $2.2 billion a year. So $1 million, you can see, is a very small amount. When Don Branchow was killed, OSHA fined SeaWorld the maximum amount that they could possibly fine them, and for willful violation, which means that they had intentionally allowed Don to be killed, and $75,000 was the max fine, and so to them, it that was nothing. I mean, and then SeaWorld proceeded to contest that amount in court, not because of the money, but because of the perception that they had allowed one of their employees to die willfully, and the fact that it would legally change whether or not they could allow animals in the water. So there was a whole big trial, but it had nothing to do with the money. It had everything to do with them trying to keep their business model in place so they could keep trainers in the water doing the big tricks off the animal's nose. The way that trial turned out, in fact, the violation got reduced from willful to serious, but OSHA is still on top of SeaWorld, and to date they have not put a trainer back in the water with the killer whales. They are starting to begin waterwork sessions again behind the scenes, but they haven't publicly seen those things that you'll see, you know, in the shows where somebody's diving off the nose of the killer whale. They haven't done that for over 2.5 years because they took all the trainers out of the water after Don was killed. And
was
good?
There any civil action against them?
That's kind of interesting too. There are two factions going on there. Don's family, on her side of the family, SeaWorld basically paid them off. I call them cash washed, like brainwashed. They get SeaWorld started a foundation in Don Branchow's name, and it's called the Don Branchow Foundation. And her family has gone on TV and publicly supported SeaWorld, saying Don died doing what she loved, and she would never want to see this animal being put down. So on that side of the family, they have not publicly said anything against the company. On the other hand, Don's husband Scott Branchow, who is also a SeaWorld employee, he was a water skier. He did retain a lawyer, and he went to the entire OSHA proceedings. So he went. It was divided into two sections in November of 2011, and then this spring in 2012. He went to all the proceedings with his lawyer, but so far nothing has come of that. So we actually thought that there would be a civil suit after OSHA found SeaWorld guilty, but so far nothing has come of it. The other two people who had lawsuits against SeaWorld, one was Linda Simons, the safety employee, and then somebody else in the and the human resource department both all of a sudden recanted their statements against the company line by line and went through and recanted everything. So we're pretty sure that those guys got paid off. So those suits are not actually in the works anymore. There have been, what I didn't talk about was prior to my being hired at the park, there were at least 30 known incidents between killer whales and trainers. I didn't know anything about that when I worked at the park, and several of those involved civil suits, and those were all also very settled out of court and hushed up, and they're, you know, those documents are not open to the public. So SeaWorld has been very successful until now, until this book, until people have started actually speaking about it. They've been very successful about keeping what goes on behind the scenes out of the public eye. So even in one of the things that was interesting to me is when the first time Kevin came to visit me at SeaWorld, this would have been early 1990, he happened to be sitting on the airplane coming from New York next to the sister of a guy who'd been involved in one of the most serious accidents in SeaWorld history. This was in 1987. The guy's name was John Sillick. You can see this on the internet. He was riding on the back of one of the killer whales when another killer whale did a breach. So this guy is on the back of a killer whale like this, riding through the water. Another killer whale breached up and landed right smack on him and crushed him between the bottom whale and the top whale. The only reason the guy survived is because he was wearing a wetsuit. So Kevin happened to be sitting next to his sister on the airplane on the way down to visit me in Orlando, and that's how I heard about that accident. Now, I went around after hearing about it to all of the people that I knew at SeaWorld, and I said, hey, I heard about this accident in 1987. That sounds pretty serious. Does anybody know about it? And nobody, either people didn't know about it, or it was the trainer's fault, or, oh, well, you know, we've changed things since then, so that's really not a problem. So, and again, so I didn't really question further. 2 months before Dawn died, in Laura Parque, which is in Canary Islands, Spain, a guy named Alexis Martinez was doing a practice for a Christmas show. So this was a Christmas Eve. He was working with a SeaWorld whale, with a SeaWorld trainer, control trainer on stage, and he was actually killed by this whale named Quito. That death was completely hushed up. SeaWorld trainers were out of the water for a day, and then they were put back in the water. And a lot of people even at SeaWorld didn't even know about this. This came to light on Larry King Live, and SeaWorld actually again denied that it had anything to do with them, when in fact it was their whale, and it was a SeaWorld trainer who was on stage supervising the training session when this guy was killed. And so if you look proportionally, I mean, a lot of people have been killed by elephants, which is another species of animals that I really think don't belong in captivity. But if you look at the percentage of people who've been injured and now killed by killer whales, we're up to 4 captive killer whales, versus if you look at the people who've been injured or killed by elephants, the percentage is much higher for killer whales, considering the number of them that are in captivity.
So Tillicum is still there, waiting?
Tillicum's still there. They're still doing artificial insemination with him. They've trained Tillicum to roll over, they manually stimulate him, and they get his sperm, and then they ship it all over, and, you know, I'm sure they get paid big bucks for that. So he's still there as a sperm donor. Like I said, 54% of the whales in SeaWorld collection have his genes.
But they have no agreement not to put him back in the water?
Tillicum was never approved to do water work. So he technically, and that's another interesting thing, when Dawn was killed, she technically wasn't doing water work. So SeaWorld says that she wasn't doing anything. Well, first they said that she made a mistake, they allowed her hair to drift into his mouth, and then he grabbed her by the hair. We're pretty sure that's a lie. Then they said that what she was doing lying down in front of him was never approved. That's a lie. I have pictures that show, you know, tons of trainers, including her, doing the same thing hundreds, if not thousands of times. But technically what she was doing lying down in this shallow ledge of water, you know, somewhere between 4 and 6 inches deep, was not considered water work by SeaWorld. Because of Tillicum's history, he'd been taken from the wild at 4 years old, taken from his mom, put into this group with 2 other older females, and he'd basically been beaten up by these older females for his entire life before he was moved to SeaWorld. And the fact that he killed somebody else, SeaWorld considered him too dangerous to do water work with him. And at that time, he was already too large. You know, he was huge. The female whales are about 5,000 or 6,000 pounds. He was 12,000 pounds. So they never considered him worth the risk to train him on water work. So trainers didn't ever do water work with him. However, They certainly got in close enough, obviously close enough proximity with him that he was able to pull them in. And several of my friends actually were working with him, had been on his back, had done tongue tactile, rubbed his tongue. Several of my friends put themselves into a similar situation with him, and are like, nothing happened to them. So we don't really know what was going through his mind and why he snapped in this particular point. But it's hard to say. At 4 years old, they're still young. I mean, again, males don't ever leave in the what's called resident killer whale populations. Males don't ever leave the pod. What it used to be assumed when scientists first started observing killer whales in the wild, that they would see a male with all these females around, and they thought that they were seeing a patriarchal society with the head male and all of his daughters and harem. But actually, you're seeing probably the son or the grandson of one of the females. So the males leave their pod only to mate with other whales, and then they come back. So they actually stay with their mothers for life. And everything they learn from being in their family pod. So, and in fact, this is another thing about SeaWorld that I had no idea. I just thought they were killer whales. You know, what's one killer whale? I've seen one killer whale. So they're all these killer whales. But there's different they almost consider different species of killer whales. There's resident populations of killer whales that are larger. They predominantly eat fish. There are transient killer whales, which are smaller groups. If you've seen the footage from killer whales attacking sea lions off of Patagonia, those are transient whales. They eat marine mammals. And in the wild, those populations would never mix. Icelandic killer whales would never mix with New Zealand killer whales or southern resident populations. And at SeaWorld, they shove all these animals together. You know, it's like putting five people who don't speak the same language in a bathroom together, and they say, go ahead and get along, and then they breed them. One of the whales that I worked with while I was there was named Taima. She was basically the product of serial rape from a Icelandic killer whale and a transient male killer whale. This Icelandic female was shoved in the back pool with this one male just repeatedly until she got pregnant. And I was not there, I didn't see that, but apparently it was a pretty horrible situation for her, and she ended up getting pregnant with what was, you know, it was a hybrid whale. And Taima ended up being one of the more aggressive whales at the killer whale stadium. Unfortunately, also died a horrific death. We had a stillborn animal that had to be winched out of her uterus and died from a hemorrhage. So that's the kind of lives these animals live.
So do you know if they're allowed to like capture from the wild, like in the Cove movie? Do they still do that in some
cases? Well, the rule is, there's something called the Marine Mammal Protection Act in 1973, and a lot of people think that means that we're not allowed to capture cetaceans from the wild. What it actually means is that the display industry has to capture them under an educational permit, which means they have to say that they're going to be using these animals either for scientific reasons or for educational purposes. They have not captured killer whales from the wild in U.S. waters because of the bad publicity they got with the southern